So that is why the term restoration has come into show. A dental restoration or a filling is a treatment of a treatment to restore the function, integrity, morphology of the missing tooth structure resulting from caries or external trauma. These restorations or fillings, in a layman's word, are basically of two types. That is direct, that is directly placed inside the patient's mouth, or indirect. That is what Madam recently covered. That is one indirect she covered, that is a casting, and direct one she covered, that is silver amalgam. Now, if you see quickly the stages of any restoration, whenever there are caries, with the help of a cutting tool, we call it as burr or a diamond point, we cut that caries part and then we restore with the silver filling or composite filling or different type of liners and bases whenever it is required. So it is not a one-shot procedure, it has got multiple steps. And while doing all this, we need to keep in mind the health of the tooth, the physiology, the form, the function and the contour and the occlusion of the patient. So we have to be very choosy while choosing the material which is going to restore the missing part of the tooth. Now, if you see the first thing, that is dental cements, which are used as follows. They are generally used as a temporary restorative material. They are used as a permanent restorative. They can be used as a temporary luting material. They are also used for a permanent luting. They can be also used as a root canal sealer. They are used as a liners or bases for the pulp protection. So these are the places where all the dental cements which will be used and they will be applicable to us. Now, what do you mean by a cement? Cement is a substance that hardens to act as a base, liner, filling material or adhesive to bind a devices and processes to the tooth or to each other. That means the cement is an intermediate material which will be in between the restoration and the tooth. So the selection of the cement will have different criteria. So we have a different cements for different purposes. Now, whenever you come across any dental materials, then these are the six key points. As you have, your dice has got a 6 points and they have got a 6 questions to you. One should ask these 6 questions to each other whenever you are studying any cement or whenever you are answering any question in the exam, right? What is the composition of the cement? Why? Why it is indicated? Why it is not been used or why it has to be used? When? When is the right time when I mix the cement and put it inside the cavity? How? The method of application or method of loading of the cement, where the indications and precautions while doing the restorations, we have to be considered. Now, who is going to supply me this cement or this material and how it is to be useful for us? Now, if you come to the bases and liners, right? Bases are typically 1 to 2 millimeter in minimum thickness of, they can be of a minimum thickness of 0.75 millimeters also, and they are used to provide a thermal protection for the pulp. And liner is a thin insulating layer which will be given for the sake of preventing the passage of ingredients from the cement to the pulp and from the pulp to the external surface or from the external surface from the marginal leakage to the pulp. So it will act as a barrier, it will act as a chemical barrier. It is always given in a thin layer. It is given in multiple coats, but base is given in one layer itself. So that is the basic difference between the bases and liners. Now, these are the what are the uses of cements in conservative dentistry? The cements are used in conservative dentistry for luting of permanent restorations as a base and a liner, intermediate or a temporary restoration. Now, the factors which determine the use of these dental cements. One is the composition of the dental cements, the compressive strength of the dental cement, because that cement will be again filled with the restorative material and it has to bear the compressive strength or the occlusion stresses, so the compressive strength is more important. Now, modulation of elasticity, because the tooth has got some amount of flexibility also, right? And the film thickness, because the film thickness will definitely play a role as a mechanical barrier. Then it will also should have the property of solubility. It should be less soluble inside the oral fluids or the irritants which are coming from the margins, or it should be less soluble in the saliva. Now, some of the ideal properties of dental cement, that it should be strong and hard to withstand the condensation force inside the cavity and to withstand the masticatory forces once it is set and it is given below the resolution. It should be insoluble in saliva. It should be dimensionally stable. That means once it is placed inside the cavity, it should stay at that place and it should not cause any dimensional instability so that it can give place for the permanent restoration. Then it should be adhesive to the tooth as well as it should be adhesive to the permanent restorative material. It should be non-porous. If the cements are porous, then it might give way to the bacteria to go inside to the pulp. So that is why these cements should not be porous. Then it will lose its strength, it will lose its mechanical property. The biocompatibility and the non-irritant property of the cement is most important because they are close to the pulp, which is the vital part of the, one of the vital part of the tooth, and is closer to the dentine also. Now the coefficient of thermal expansion is one of the most important property of all the cements, all the restorative materials should have, so that it can flex or it can expand and contract as per the tooth. Because if there is a lot of difference between a coefficient of expansion and contraction, then there will be a disparity between the restorative material and the tooth. It should be effective thermal. It should not be affected by the thermal changes and moisture. It should give a good barrier below the restoration. It should have sufficient flow. It should have good wetting ability so that it can flow to the different parts of the cavity when it is inserted. And it should have a sufficient film thickness for the use. Now these cements which are there, which is the most common question that will classify dental cements and explain one of it in detail. Now all the physical properties and the numerical values are given in the textbook, but this is the most commonly used question that's classified dental cements. Now there are different ways the cements are classified. They are based like conventional cement and the resin based cements. Now then they are also classified according to the reaction, that is acid based reaction, light or chemical activated, or only chemically activated, or polymerizing cement. This is according to how the cement is going to set, these are classified. Now there is one more classification of cement which is given as per the uses, that is the principal use and the secondary use. Zinc phosphate cement is used for lining, restoration and orthodontic appliances. And secondary, it can be used as an intermediate restorative or a thermal insulating base. That doesn't mean that it is used as a restorative material. No, it is used as a temporary or intermediate restoration before going for a permanent restoration. So that difference you should be able to make it. And during the Viva, majority of the students, they make mistake in the primary use and the secondary use. Now zinc oxide eugenol cement, they are temporary restorative material. They are used as a cavity liners and pulp capping agent. They can be also used as a root canal sealer and periodontal surgical dressing. So according to the use of each and every cement, they have been given as a primary use and a secondary use. Now by doing this, they have considered, while using them in a different places, they have to consider the different physical and chemical properties of the cement and the nature of the cement, how it behaves when it comes in contact with the tooth. Now if you see the silicate cement, it is more acidic, it is more irritant, so it is used only as a restoration purpose. It has got some drawbacks, that is why it is not so commonly used. It uses is reduced now. For glass ionomer cement, it has got a multiple varieties and variants are available for the different uses. Now calcium hydroxide. Again, calcium hydroxide is pulp capping and thermal insulating weight, and it can be used as a temporary restoration. But it can be. It is not the primary function of that. It is mainly used for pulp capping and insulating bases. Now these cements are also classified as a permanent luting cements, temporary luting cements, temporary restorative cements, and different types are there. Like type 1 is used for temporary luting, then permanent restoration type 2 glass ionomer is used for temporary restorative material, zinc oxide reinforced type 3 is used. So these cements are again reclassified according to their use. Now as their application, wherever they are used, whenever they are used as their bases, cavity liners, under the composite restoration, when you talk about the cavity liners, which are the cavity liners are used, that is calcium hydroxide, type 2 glass ionomer and different vinyls. When you use, they can use them as a pulp capping agent, that is indirect pulp capping, calcium monoxide and zinc oxide. Direct pulp capping agent, that is calcium oxide. Now, coming to the next step, that is the manipulation of the cement. Irrespective of whichever cement you are using for the purpose which has been selected, there are different ways in which the cement is used or it is manipulated. Manipulation means mixing of the cement. Now, there are specific instructions given for zinc oxide, for zinc phosphate, for glass ionomer. For example, zinc oxide, eugenol can be used, can be mixed with a glass slab and a stainless steel spatula. When you want to use a zinc phosphate cement, you have to make it in small increments and you have to cover the larger area so that it's an exothermic reaction. The heat will get absorbed by the longer surface of the glass and you will get more manipulation time. When you're using a glass ionomer, you have to use an agate or a plastic spatula so that you don't abrade the stainless steel spatula and incorporate that into your glass ionomer. So this is how the manipulation of each and every cement is advocated and it has to be used. Now, after proper manipulation or mixing, the protection of the cement during a setting, that there should be a proper isolation so that it should not get contaminated by the saliva. Once the cement is set, we have to wait till the time, the setting time, then it has to be finished and polished on time so that it can go ahead for the further restoration. Now, these are the common terminologies which are relatedly asked whenever the questions related to cement is used. What is the water powder ratio? What is the powder liquid ratio? Coefficient of thermal expansion, solubility, water sorption, tensile strength, compressive strength, and the wear resistance. All these things are interdependent, but they are most important when it comes to each and every